All right, so I'm getting my paint put into my roller tray. The roller tray and the roller size just really kind of depends on how much you're doing of what color. We're doing one color for all three rooms today, so we're gonna use a 14-inch roller. This nap is a half-inch nap. It's already been used in a job and washed, so I don't need to de-lint it. Otherwise, I would probably wrap tape around it, take the lint off the roller before it's used for the first time. I always leave a bunch of junk in your paint coat. You also don't want it too heavy because you're gonna be carrying this around. So I'm probably gonna pour a little bit of this out. For a bathroom, you're gonna have the additional setup of a pretty pail with a plastic liner installed. And then we're using a jumbo mini roller with 3/8-inch nap. I'm grabbing the brush kind of like this, pinching it with my thumb and my finger. And then I'm coming in, getting on the last step in this ladder, coming in like this. I'm usually getting rid of the excess paint right away. So I'm coming down, getting rid of it there, and then I'm coming up to it. If I go right up to it with a lot of paint, it's gonna end up getting on the ceiling. It's not gonna be a nice cut line. And I'm dipping in the bucket, shaking it, getting it off the backside and cutting. Then I'm gonna come back and just jab at it real quick. I'm trying to give it a little bit of texture, so it kind of tries to match the roller stipple. And then the last piece is just to take the brush this way and taper that end off so you don't have a lip right here where it could possibly sag on you. So this person that's cutting the ceilings is also gonna cut the walls here into this corner down. Not all the way. Down over here, this spot's dry. I'm gonna spot prime this holes that we had filled earlier. Nice to be able to get all those areas spot prime so they don't flash off, especially since we're using quick set mud. It doesn't take paint the best. This part, real fast. That's why we have the tape down. Get our, you know, we're only really worried about this bottom edge. We wanna get that edge. We don't want to miss it, so we'll go over it a couple of times. We don't need to be coming way up here. Cut in around these boxes quick. Biggest mistake I see new painters make, whether they're brushing or rolling, is they overextend. They dry brush or they dry roll. The paint doesn't go as far as you think it's going to go. You gotta constantly be dipping in there to get your tool saturated. You're gonna work slow. You're also gonna not get the right coverage if you're putting it on dry.
The biggest difference when you're cutting in a bathroom is that after you do your cut-in, you're gonna use a mini roller to get tight to your fixtures behind toilets and whatnot so that you don't see any brush marks. Anytime you mini roll like behind a toilet, you're not going to use a mini roller for the entire wall, but you don't want to stop here and go do something else. You want to finish this wall entirely. So have your 9-inch roller out and ready to go and finish the rest of this wall so you don't have any flashing.
Heights 12, 15, sometimes 18 feet. You're going to need to use the possibility of an extension ladder. We have a multi-ladder to use, so that's got a lot of different functionalities. A little bit heavier, and then we have this telescoping ladder. So that's probably what you're gonna use most of the time. It's a little bit easier to use because it's lighter. And we also have a pivot tool. So the pivot tool is gonna be what is gonna level out your stairs. So you put it on a stair edge like that. So if you have to go up to the ceiling up there, you put this down and it's gonna level your ladder out. So it is safe to use. On some of the ladders that we have, there's a notch on each one of these rungs that you can press and it'll lower down each rung, so you can, it's a little bit more flexible. With this ladder, it has only one safety, so it doesn't just drop it down right on your hand. It kind of has a little bit of give there. You notice that we also have some rags here taped onto the end. We just don't want to mar up the walls. So if I want to raise this up, and let's say I don't have to have it all the way extended, this one is a 12 and a half foot long. I have to pick it up from the bottom here. And then it locks. It won't lock from the top here. You see it doesn't lock. You have to go from the bottom first and pull it up like that. If I knew I was gonna extend it all the way, then I can pull from the top. I'm gonna get this extended all the way up. So now I can use it just like this and I can reach the ceiling no problem here. Obviously it's a little bit trickier when you have to go up this wall because of the stairs. So I would just put this down right here, one on the stair tread and one on the pivot tool, and climb up that. I get to this next part and I'm gonna have to lower it down. Just help it along a little bit here. So I'll bring it up. Probably don't need much more than that. And then I'll set this pivot tool up right here. So now I can reach everything I couldn't there and come back over. The other way you can do this is to use a multi-ladder. You just kind of extend one section of the legs while you keep that side still, and then drop your ladder down. See that this thing is quite a bit heavier and a little bit more cumbersome, but then I can go ahead and cut this, drop it down to my next section here, get this cut in right here, but then I get to a spot where I have this area to do. You can still do it from this. You have to probably fold this out into an extension so it's going straight up. But that's where the telescoping ladder kind of makes stairways a little bit easier. Let's just assume that I wanted to, this is the only tool I had on me. Just there, and then I gotta pop these on each side. And then fold it out into an extension to cut in. So the most common places I'm gonna use one of these ladders is gonna probably be in an entryway. Maybe it's 18 feet tall. It's consistent height all the way around. And I don't have to maneuver the ladder a lot. I don't have to change the height of it a lot. Versus this, I'm gonna use it more likely in a stairway. Where there's gonna be a lot of change in height. Yeah, so when I'm working up on a ladder, just like when I'm working outside, you take a ladder hook, wrap it over the front of your rung, and go ahead and cut these ceilings in. It's really no different than if you're on a 2-foot ladder or a extension ladder. But I do try to get really as much as I can. So I'm gonna go left-handed here and just bring this over so I can minimize the amount of ladder movements that I have. Really important to do the chop technique here, because we're going to be cutting in twice, and these stairwells usually have a decent amount of natural light coming in. And also you're looking down at the cut line, so it's a lot more visible. So you do the chop, or you can back roll it with a mini roller, your cut line, so that you have consistent stipple all the way across. Okay, so we're in a section right now that we can't hit with this ladder. It's 12 and a half feet. We're going down the steps. It makes it a little bit taller. You can see that little 2-foot section there. We have a multi-ladder that we can use, but the multi-ladder base is too long, too wide for to go across the step to a pivot tool. So we can either remove one of the sections from the multi-ladder, or we can just use like a 16 or 20-foot extension. This is the only little piece that we need in this entire house to use for an extension ladder. So instead of going out to the truck and unrigging the extension ladder from the top of the truck, I'm just gonna use the multi-ladder that we already have inside. I'm just gonna take this, flip that over, cutting. I'm going to test my footing. Now, when I paint a stairway, I always cut it twice. I cut it twice and then roll it twice, because we're going to be resting the ladder on the wall. We don't want to mar up our finish. To protect this wall so we can accent this wall, we're going to use 12-inch plastic with 1.5 inch yellow frog tape. This wall was previously painted a while ago, so we don't really have to worry about it. We could probably use blue frog tape, but we're gonna assume that we were painting this entire bedroom and this is a fresh coat of paint. So you'd wanna let this dry for at least 2 or 3 hours before you mask it off. Otherwise you have a chance of maybe peeling that paint off, even if you're using the yellow frog tape. But
don't apply the masking directly into the corner. Bump it back about 1/16 of an inch away from your accent wall.
So I'm gonna take the clear caulking and I'm gonna spread this clear caulking into this corner. You don't need a heavy bead, you're just trying to kind of seal that tape.
Take your 1.5 inch knife and wipe out all of the excess. You really just want a tiny bit of amount of caulk to seal the tape. You don't want to build the corner up with caulk before you lay your coat of paint on.
I have a nice heavy coat on here. Sure, since you're laying such a heavy coat, make sure that you fan it out along your edges here. Apply a second coat right away. Use a real light touch here because you're not waiting for that first coat to fully dry. You are going to end up rolling these walls tight into this corner. So you really just have to make sure you get good coverage, that 1/8 of an inch into that corner that you can't hit with your roller. Finishing my stroke up into my wet paint. I'm gonna get this tape and plastic removed right away. I'll start from the top down. Just be real careful not to let the wet edge of this paint roll over onto the previously painted surface.
The key with this technique is to not let that caulk dry, so the masking should really be removed within 5 minutes of applying that caulking. After you have your two wet coats along your accented wall, you can cut in and roll your walls just like you normally would any other paint application.
You're probably only going to be using a roller, a 9-inch roller like this, for this one wall. And it's probably brand new, so you really want to make sure it's worn in a little bit. The paint is completely saturated the roller before you get up close to this corner. And you also want to make sure that this, when you roll into this corner, you don't have a loaded up roller. You're going to go along this line really close and really carefully. Keep an eye, make sure that cage on the roller frame doesn't hit the adjacent wall.
So that's the basics on accenting the wall. Now we're going to get into changing the color on an outside corner.
Okay, so here's another example where you have maybe two colors come together. Let's say that this is going to be one color, this hallway is going to be a different color. You might think that you could use a roller just right up to this edge, but the reality is that the pile on this roller is gonna end up wrapping around this corner, and you're gonna end up seeing little pieces of paint along this edge. It won't be a sharp, clean line. So when I load the paint onto this brush, I'm not gonna load that much because I'm gonna carefully cut this in around this edge. Now this is the same color as this wall. So you're gonna have to use imagination a little bit because we're not gonna actually accent this wall. However, you know, when the paint first goes on, it is a slightly different color until it dries down completely. So you'll be able to see the difference here. So as I come into the ceiling, I don't want to have a lot of paint right up next to the edge. I wanna come at it from probably a 40 degree angle where the bristles are aimed down this way at the ceiling. And I'm gonna just carefully come into this edge. Now for this corner, I'm going to cut it next to it, leaving about 1/8 of an inch. And I'm going to get the bristles wrapped around this way. So it's at a 45 degree angle this way. You don't want to come too straight on. You don't want to come at it from a 90 degree angle because then the bristles can easily wrap over this edge and get on this wall. So now I'm going to just kind of come at it like this. And you can kind of just check it like this real quick with your hand. Make sure that nothing's wrapped around that corner.
And the last piece is to roll your paint right up to that corner, but you want to leave about 1/8 inch. You don't want to overlap it like you see in this example. While you're taking care of your first cut-in, if you see paint from the wall up on the ceiling, you're going to want to take care of this. A lot of times we'll notice this during the estimate process and we'll make notes in the work order, but sometimes we can't see it. And this is how you're going to want to handle that situation and talk to the customer about it.
And they got paint all over their ceiling. They had asked me when I came out to bid the project to kind of touch that up. I explained to them that when I do touch it up, it might not match perfect. I got to explain that to them, but realistically, you're not really going to notice a difference, especially along this corner. If they had painted the ceiling and they have the old paint, that's going to be your best bet. Then you won't see it at all, but they don't. So we're just going to use this Kills Upshot again. And I'm just going to get it sprayed lightly into this corner here. I blend it, it's going to make it so that that change in color is going to be just a little bit less noticeable. You know, sometimes we'll paint a wall, and let's say that we're painting it gray, and they had previously painted it green, and the green color is all over the ceiling. Well, you could cut it in perfect and think that you did your job, but the reality is that now you have a white ceiling, a green line from where they painted it, and then you got your new gray walls. In that kind of situation, just go around the room real quick, touch it up. You know, you probably want to talk to the homeowner about it. Let them know, like, hey, we can't get this perfect unless we do this. And when we do this, it might not match perfectly, because after this dries, if you really focused on that, you might see it very slightly. So it's a good thing to just talk to them about it. So here's your option, or, you know, we paint your whole ceiling. So now we're on to rolling the walls, the first coat. So I'm gonna get it nice and saturated first. I like working right to left and always keeping my frame edge on that right to left, so it's always gonna be on the left side. I'm not gonna start in the corner when I have a loaded up roller. It's gonna put on way too much paint in that corner. I'm gonna kind of just get it out like this. And then I'm gonna come into the corner. Now that it has kind of like a reasonable amount of paint on there. And right now I'm just trying to get it on. I'm maybe a 30% overlap. Nothing pretty about it right now. I'll do another stretch here. Kind of off to the side again, come down, up to the top, down. And I'm going as high as I can to the top without hitting the ceiling. And then all the way to the bottom trim. Now I'm gonna come back and lay the paint off. So I go this way and have the frame edge there, and I twist the pull here just a slight bit that way. It puts a little bit of pressure on that left edge, and that way it kind of tapers the paint on the right edge. So I'm gonna come down and lay this paint off. I don't have to put a ton of pressure on this roller. And I'm always gonna go top to bottom. I'm just trying to get rid of any lines. Get a nice consistent finish. And then when I come into edges like this, I can't get tight to it, so I'm gonna flip it over so I can roll tight to that frame. You don't get any of that boxing effect that way. Switch it back here so I can get tight to this outlet cover. I'm gonna lay this off. When I come up above a door frame or a window, I'm not gonna load quite as much paint on this roller because I don't wanna have it sag on me. So I'm gonna get it applied to this whole area first, and then I'm gonna come and actually roll it on here. See, I'm always flipping it when I gotta get tight to one edge. Now I'm gonna come back and lay this off. Again, not a lot of paint because I'm just coming up underneath here. I'm gonna get that rolled in there, and then I'll lay it off. Another big mistake I see people make, just like with brushing, is they try to extend the roller way too far. It's really dry. So So right now I can hear it start to hiss at me. I know it's done. I shouldn't be spreading it out any further. I'll see painters, they'll try to go and they put a ton of pressure on there, try to get it completely covered. All you gotta do is load up some more paint. I like to roll everything that I can.
Make sure you don't get too far ahead of yourself before you lay your paint off. Otherwise, the paint will have started to set up already.
Get this bottom rolled out so we get our stipple tight to that base. I usually always keep my tray ahead of me, work into the tray. Now, ideally, when you lay it off, you go all the way from the top to the bottom, light pressure all the way down.
It can be a little bit more challenging to lay off your finish from top to bottom without stopping. We do have 16-foot extensions, which can help in like an entryway as long as you have enough room. But you really just want to do your best to get a nice consistent stroke all the way from the top to the bottom. That way you don't have any stop marks.
Now, if I went like this and I just stopped right there and left it, you're going to see a stop mark. The shine's going to be different right there. That's why it's real important, especially when you have a lot of natural light coming in, to get it laid off where it's all the stipples go in one direction. And you try to go top to bottom.
Remember to get a fan running in the areas that you've painted so you can get that first coat drying down faster.
We've got a small spot here where it was hit with a roller. If that happens, we always keep Kills Upshot. It's available at Home Depot, so if we don't have it at the shop, but you should be able to grab this for every project. Let's say it happened in a well-lit area and it happens for some reason in the middle of the ceiling. This might not work because you might see it still. So you might have to paint the whole ceiling in that situation. But since this is along the edge, this is kind of how I usually deal with this, is you just lightly get this put up here and then take a rag and kind of dab at it a little bit around the edges to try to get it to blend.
Now that we have our first coat of paint applied, we're going to take care of our drywall dings and nail pops, really examine the walls for any defects before we apply our final coat of paint. Let's say you're only painting one bedroom, then you're probably going to want to take care of all of your repairs, including the dings and the nail pops, before your first coat of paint. That way you don't have to wait on anything to dry.
I'm going to go through and check all the spots and make sure everything's filled. So, good to take a light with you here. Check over everything real good. Get it shining at like a 45 degree angle here on the wall. I can see that I got some holes here. All these are gonna get two coats pinned tight so you can see I'm wiping it all off. I don't wanna have hardly any sanding to do here. A couple of small pin holes here. I see a little bit of a gouge up here. If I see anything raised on the surface, I'm going to take my knife, pluck it off like that. Okay, so we're on our final coat of mud here. We don't really need the light to go everywhere because we already spotted everything on that first coat. So I just gotta go find the spots that I already did and hit those again. Going down, cross it, down, cross it. It's important you do the second coat, otherwise it's gonna shrink a little bit. And you will see that spot.
I take a fine sanding sponge, focus a little bit on those spackle spots, make sure that nothing's sitting proud on the surface. And then you're gonna take your 360 sander with 150 grit and hit the walls again, top to bottom. Now you wanna apply your second and likely final coat of paint. Not a huge difference here, applying the second coat versus the first coat. The brush does glide a little bit faster, especially if you're using an eggshell paint. The main difference you'll see is that the cut-in person on the ceilings is going to want to spot prime all of the spackle repairs. To spot prime the spackle, you want a real thin coat of paint. So I'm taking the brush that was dipped down there and spreading it out amongst four or five holes. And then I'm taking a real light touch and fanning that out so there's no brush marks at all. You're really just trying to seal that spackle so that you don't have any flashing before you roll your final coat.
Getting this roller super loaded up. Don't be afraid to put a ton of paint on there. And as you're carrying it over to the wall, you just tip the roller like this, right over the wall. The more paint you can get on that roller, especially in a wide open wall, you should do it. It's going to make it go quite a bit faster. When you get into tight areas above door frames, above windows and stuff, then you're going to kind of be a little bit more careful with how much paint you're loading on your roller. Again, I'm just putting a little bit of pressure on the left side of the frame, and I'm basically just letting the weight of the roller kind of bring it down.
That concludes part two of interior wall painting. Now we're going to get into removing masking and just general cleanup.